myself to ridicule the gloomy message on the Roman text, 1 Timothy 1:5. The textbook runs like this. It says, "The end of the commandment," that's King James, or as some translations say, I think a better translation would be, "The goal of our instruction is." The end of the commandment is what? It's a law. Rising out of a pure heart, and out of a good conscience, and out of a genuine faith. That's God's goal. If you're shooting with a rifle at a target at 100 yards and you miss the bullseye by 2 inches, and you shot at the moon and miss it by the same incidence, you'd miss it by 7,000 miles. Which is to say, if you don't have the right goal to start with, the further you travel down the road, the further you get away from the truth. A guidance counselor once told me, said that, you know, there are 40,000 different occupations open to people today. We never tell the students that they would never make it. We just tell them there's 400. God has a goal for every Christian. And sometimes people say, well, I don't have that kind of a personality, you know. There's nothing wrong with your personality. It's God's goal for you, for me, for everybody. Why did God give us the Bible? Why did men risk their lives and give their lives in the writing of the Bible? The story of the writing of the Bible is not a story. But there's a lot of blood connected with it, you know. Why all this push? Why did God do this? What was his goal? What did he have in mind? One text tells us very clearly why he did it, why they did it. And I found something else in the prayer of Jesus in John 17. As he came to the end of his prayer, he said, "I have declared unto them your name," the 12. "I've declared unto them your name, and will declare it, that the one who are with you have loved me may be in them, and I in them." So Jesus' teaching for 3.5 years with the 12 had this in mind, that he might produce a group of men full of the love of God. "Because though I speak in the tongue of men and of angels, and have not love, I'm a clanging gong or a clashing cymbal. I'm just a noise." And then Hosea and Amos, God spoke about the howlings in the temple. The Psalms in the temple, he called them howlings. He called them prayer howlings. "You will not cry unto me when you howl in your beds." So singing and praying may be just a howling, just a noise. God said that Pharaoh King Jesus, he's just a noise. And sometimes it's all we are, you know. If we don't have the love of God, we're just a noise. Just a noise. I can get my body to be burning. If I didn't do it, the love of God in my soul, I did a stupid thing, you know. I can give all my money to the poor, and if it wasn't done with the love of God in my soul, you just did a very stupid thing. And God said, I can't find a definition of love in the Bible, but the closest to it is found in 1 Corinthians 13, where it says, "Love, whatever it is, love seeks not her own." And you can judge your actions by that. Am I doing this? Am I seeking my own? Am I seeking someone else's welfare? "Let no man seek his own," the Bible says, "but every man another's welfare, another's good." So Philippians chapter 2 has a lot to say about that, and so much of the Bible. So, the goal of God's instruction in giving us the Bible is that he might produce in us people filled with his His will. It was His will. You want to read about the Moravians, how sometimes they would go and sell themselves as slaves in the slave market so they could be transported to some slave colony somewhere in the world. You would know where they'd end up. They never have a furlough, they would never see the loved ones again, they might be beaten and tortured, they didn't care. They just want to find some people they could preach to. And so they sold themselves as slaves in the slave markets. Now, we'll have to admit that's wrong. And in China, during the Cultural Revolution, when young people were allowed to go around the country and target rich people, religious people, and so on, thousands of people brutally murdered. They sometimes broke the homes of clubs and just clubbed everybody to death, you know, Christians or whatever. In one case, they broke into a Christian home and they clubbed the whole family to death. But the mother survived. They didn't know that, but they survived. After a while, this man became a disrepute because he was just too getting out of control, and he stopped. And when this mother found out that the guy who led this group into her home and murdered her family was living only 2 blocks from her place, so how did she handle it? She started praying for him. And then she heard he had a sick child, and he had no money, and he couldn't get any help, medical help, and so she went down. Now, he didn't recognize him. She didn't say anything. He thought about that awful night. And she said, I'd like to help you and our nursing boy. If you'd like to be glad to do that for you. And so she nursed his boy for 3 weeks until he came back to help, and she took him home. And she gave the boy to her dad. She told the dad who she was. That awful night. You know what happened? He fell on the floor, began to weep and weep and weep. And he cried for mercy from God and asked for forgiveness and make of God and got saved. How could she do that? How could she do that? She was filled with the love of God, obviously, you know. Love seeks no union. Always keep that in mind. When you're evaluating perhaps the temper of your own love, love seeks none own. Never trying to build up itself or its program, but seeking to help others. Doing what we can, and no influence we have in this world, doing what we can to help other people. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. I sometimes use the illustration of the average Christian living in a tin can, a big tin can, at the side of the road watching the plane go by. You know? He's got one-way glass, nobody can see in, but he can see out. And nobody can get in there, he's in there, he's got a secret entrance, and so there he sits, watching the parade go by. How many Christians are like that, you know? Just watching the parade go by. It's not really doing anything, not helping anybody. They see people going past and need help. Doesn't bother them in slightest. They're just enjoying the parade. Don't be one of those. There are millions of them. Don't be one of them. So the goal of our instruction is love. But notice the qualification is love that rises out of a pure heart. Now Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the pure in heart. One of the leading men in the Life Action ministry years ago, he came to me and he said, would you prepare a special message just for us leaders in the Life Action movement on the text, blessed are the pure in heart? He says, no. Billy said, it'd be perfectly fine. My heart is so corrupt at times. If I see a cardboard box blown across a field in wind or a rusty tin can in a ditch, I have to think something evil. I mean, he said, that's the way I'm a Christian. But I have no victory over this. That's it, so I'll tell you, I fasted and I prayed and I fasted and has a pure heart. And I preached it. And I remember a dear children strike him running up. He said, oh, please. God did it. God did it in my heart. The heart was pure by the grace of God. So I'm a peace of all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. So bless them with a pure heart, for they shall see God. It is possible to have a pure heart. Men have argued with me sometimes. Christian men have said, it isn't possible. The world's so rotten and filthy, you can't have a pure heart. Why don't you tell Jesus that? Why did he put it in the Bible, you know? Sure you can have a pure heart. But you can't have a pure heart. You sit in front of the TV set all day, hours every day, soaking this garbage, a lot of this garbage. And even if you see a good program, a bad program, you follow or something in between. And so minds get polluted. A heart that devises wicked imaginations, God said, is an abomination to him. He hates that. Read Proverbs chapter 6. He hates it. A heart that devises, thinks up, wicked imagination. Ecclesiastes 7 says, God made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions. Well, I didn't know what he meant by that, so I looked up the word invention. You know what it means? It means mental fabrication. A fabrication is a lie. A mental fabrication is a mental lie. So you're thinking of being some guy's wife, and you're sleeping with someone else's wife. You're thinking that in your mind, it's a lie. It's a mental fabrication. God made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions. And you're doing that maybe all the time. You might be even thinking of living in a $2 million house. And you're not. Or something else. It's a mental fabrication. It's a lie. Don't do that. Live a real life. Live in reality. Let God guide you. Be controlled by his law. So it's not rising out of a pure heart. You can't have, you can't be filled with the love of God if you do have a pure heart. So you've got to work at it. We all have to work at that. So blessed. Blessed means, oh, how happy. Oh, how happy. Blessed are the pure heart. For they shall see God in ways that other people will never see God in this world. Then, out of a pure conscience. People say, I'm going by my conscience. And then you might wind up in hell following your conscience, you know. The Bible says you may have a good conscience. It also says you may have a weak conscience, or an evil conscience, a sin conscience, or a dead conscience. All these words are used in describing a man's conscience. Paul said, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost. That's the kind of conscience we need to have. Okay? A pure conscience. And some of you maybe heard this illustration before. It was down in Chile, when you brought a man to me, he didn't know any English, not even know any Spanish, and so the interpreter told me what he had in mind. He says he has a very bad conscience, and he wants me to pray for him. I said, well, you tell me this. In chapter Hebrews 13, it says, pray for us, for we trust we have a good conscience, and all things willing to live honestly. So I tell him that. So he told me, I just walked away. And the guy called after him, he wanted to pray for him. And I said, listen, tell us now. No. The Bible says, I'm not going to pray for him until he has a clear conscience. Tell him to go home and get his conscience cleared up. So he told me, I just walked away. Did I do the right thing? The next night he came back with the interpreters. He heard me. He was talking so fast and laughing crying at the same time. He went home. And he spent hours on his face before God asking God to clean up his conscience. And he dealt with all kinds of things, made restitution. But he was just full of God, you know. A good conscience. Made good by the Spirit of God. It has to be the Spirit of God and the Word of God. Pray for us, for we trust we have a good conscience and all things willing to live honestly. Okay. So make sure your conscience is right. It may not accuse you of anything, it may simply be because it's not activated, maybe dead, maybe sick, maybe evil, maybe defiled. So so. Don't go by that. We hinder by their conscience. They sometimes they throw bodies in the Ganges River, you know. They do all kinds of things their conscience tells them to do. It's not their conscience. It's something that they think is their conscience. It's not that at all. Now, in one sense, conscience is connected closely with knowledge. If you know a thing is right, do it. You don't wait for your conscience to tell you what to do. The conscience, I say, has a lot to do with knowledge. So, the goal then is love, rising out of a pure heart, a good conscience, and then it talks about a genuine faith. Now James says, show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. I like that. That's a good saying. And so, our works should show our faith. And James, remember, he said, the demons also believe, and they tremble. Just because you see you have some faith in God, may not mean very much. The demons have that much. Not faith, but understanding, you know who God is. And maybe that's all the knowledge we may have of God sometimes. Some people who profess to be a Christian. So have a genuine faith. And you know, faith, I think, has to do with the promises of God. I mentioned this before, 7,487 pounds in the Bible. Dr. Herbert Locke wrote a book on it. And so I'm in Dixon, Canada, with all the work is done. I don't know if you can get the book anymore. 7,487 promises. And I know what some people are thinking, maybe like, no. Yeah, but they're not all for me. Of course they're not all for you. Why don't you cut it in half? Why don't you take just 3,000? Wouldn't 3,000 be enough to get you by? I mean, you can reduce it to 1,000 if you want to. I think to myself, you know, that one promise would be enough almost for the whole of my life. Casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Wouldn't that take care of life quite fully? I think it would. So, a long rising of the pure heart. Oh, I say again, blessed are the pure heart, for they shall see God. Oh, how happy are the pure in heart, full of peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. You can be holy. You can have a pure heart, but you have to come on God's terms. And you have to break. You know, I talked the other day about coming out from among them, being separate. There's another verse in Hebrews 13 that says, Jesus, that He might sanctify the people's own blood, suffered outside the gate. Let us go forth therefore unto Him outside the camp. So it's not just a matter of, you know, being separate, coming out, being separate, but being separated with Christ. His name is not popular. I'm saying real. Jesus is a crucial word. You start talking about Jesus. I remember one time in the barber shop a year and a half ago. I had my hair cut and I witnessed to the guys there. Nobody said anything. I was back a month or two later to get a haircut. And you see, every time you get your hair cut, they actually have six haircuts, you get one free, you know. And we keep working with that. So the gal said, no, she checked it. Oh, she said, your name's not here. Well, so it's here before. And they take my name off, you know, off the list. They're not happy with me. And it's good to know that sometimes. It's praise the Lord. God's happy. So what does it mean if other people are not happy, you know? It doesn't mean much. So a pure heart, a good conscience, and a genuine faith. My faith looks up to Thee, Thou the Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray. Take all my guilt away. Oh, let me from this day be holy wine. What a thought. What a thought. My faith looks up to Thee. Our faith in Christ, like Paul said in Acts 20, he preached two things. He preached no that, but there are two central things he preached, and one is this: repentance towards God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. But you know, it's hard to exercise faith relative to any matter if you don't have a promise to go with you. So when God told Abraham and Sarah, "You're going to have a child of your own," Abraham didn't blow it, his name might have been. It says he didn't stagger at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform, and how Sarah handled it. She conceived seed when she was past age because she judged him faithful who had promised. So it wasn't the same thing just believing God. It's a simple thing. God said it, I believe it, that settles it, right? That's how it should be. Faith, mighty faith, the promises, and looks to God alone, last of impossibilities in Christ, it shall be done. And Christ, it shall be done. And Christ, it shall be done. Last of impossibilities in Christ, it shall be done. Faith, mighty faith, the promises, and looks to God alone. What's faith? You know, based on the promises of God, believing God no matter what, trusting God no matter what, waiting on God. He said wait, and wait in any language means wait. And sometimes it may be a long way. You know, people who committed family problems to God, and within 24 hours the problems were resolved. I know of cases like that. I know of a case where it was 2 weeks before anything happened. And in one case where it was 3 weeks before the last of the family got converted. And then I know others were 8 weeks, some maybe a year, 2 years. The time now is important. Wait on the Lord. He'll never forget. He doesn't forget. He doesn't have a secretary reminding him about promises he's made. He doesn't have that. Let me ask you a question. How can God listen to and answer 6 million people praying at once? But he has to do that constantly. There's millions of Christians around the world, and we often pray at the same time other people are praying. How does God handle this? We can never handle them, but how does God handle that? It just gives us a little idea of the immensity of this intellect, of who he is. Because there's another question you might ask, how is God able to count the stars? How could he count the stars? It's impossible. How could he name the stars? He gave names to every star in the universe. How could he do that? People are saying there's probably as many stars in the universe as there are grains of sand on the seashores in the world. That may be a good comparison. I think it is. But how could it listen? We're talking about God in that sense. It's not man. He held the waters of the sea upon his hand, right? Even there's a word there about tears that says, the tears, in talking about the dust of the world, I looked this up, it means three. In three fingers, he held all the dust of the world. And so, he's this kind of a God. Our God is so tiny and small. We argue with God sometimes. It's a waste of time. Praise God for who he is. We're just a little. It's not a case of an ant and an elephant, dear people. It would be an insult to God to compare us to an ant and him to an elephant. It's much beyond that. Great is our God, and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Great is our God. Praise him. All we have to get prepared to be filled with the love of God. So we have to have three things, right? Love rising out of what? Okay. All right. So we need to be emptied of self, remembering gain, love seeks not her own. Love seeks not her own. When people say, I love you, it may mean something, it may not mean anything. Love seeks not her own. Well, Jesus said, continue in my love. So it asks us to continue to love. Let's see, Jude, it says, keep yourselves in the love of God. Well, how can I do that? I think what he's talking about there is, you know, bad things happen to us, happens to all of us at times. And so we get sour, we get angry, we get upset, and we no longer feel the word of God. But it says, keep yourself in the love of God. Don't let that happen. Something bad will happen, well, get on top of it. Don't let it sit on your shoulder, you get on top of it. This is something you see before the distance, you know. So, keep yourself, continue in my love. Start every day. Have a little talk with the Lord. Ask Him to fill you with His love for that day. And you know, every day you live, your faith will be challenged and your love will be challenged. And sometimes by close members of your family, too. When Paul spoke about approving ourselves as God's servants, he talked about by distresses and by necessities. You ever thought of that? Could work, you know, some of you know him. He told me of some distress he had staying at home one time. He was preaching in bush camps and staying at home in the bush there, you know. And the woman had to have a door on. And so many times I was laying in bed crying, the two kids climbing up my back, you know. Have you ever had that happen? Kids climbing up her back while you're praying. I called him a necessity. He couldn't get into the bucket, you know. I stayed in home one time, and the next door room, there was in that room a bunch of drums. And the kids loved the drums. And I had to get used to the pounding of the drums, you know. If it's a necessity, I couldn't say anything. If you would have been offended. My wife and I were down in a place in Bayfront, mainland Regina. My wife and I together, we saw the sign, two guys with diamonds, and the screamer, Regina, how do we get back into Canada? And the guy in front of him, no, he said, it's Regina, Regina, oh, Regina, spelled the same, you know. So we're standing in a wealthy man's home, and down there, the wood is very scarce, and so everything's done with concrete and stones, you know. So the floors were all two-story house and cement, you know. And we had this bed. It was a big bed, and we had a canopy over it and everything. It was a beautiful thing until we got into it. The minute we got in, we rolled together and we hit the floor. Okay. And then we looked at each other, we were laughing, and we could hardly even get out again, you know. So we didn't know what to do. We got out of the bed, we looked at the certain thing. So we took the mattress off the frame and laid it on the cement floor and had a good sleep. When we got in, I told the pastor, oh, he said, don't let the people know. They'll be horrified. Well, it was a necessity. You see something happen. It's not always the way we like it to order it. So we have to live with it. And thank God for it. The guy sleeping and he was having trouble. It was a bad bed, you know. And his friend heard him praise the Lord. Heard him say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Finally, he says, he had a better bed. And he goes, what are you praising the Lord for? He said, I'm just thanking the Lord. I got two sides so I can turn, you know. So simple for you. Distresses, necessities, things you can't change, you have to live with. Well, that's part of it, you know. Taking it patiently. And God is working on our behalf to make us a love-filled instrument that He can use in a world that's lost its way. Okay. Walk in love as Christ also loved us. He's given himself for us, an offering, a sacrifice to God for sweet smelling fragrance. I said this before, it's a way of life. It is not something you put on to meet an emergency. Don't make that mistake. It's a way of life. We should always be walking in love. And I've been home sometimes when a boy comes to ask his dad something, his dad, he's bursting aside, doesn't he miss it, you know. It's Well, in a few years, this kid will find a man who listens to him. And maybe a man in the street, a bad guy, you know. And then the parents will cry, and what happened to my kid? I raised him as a Christian. I raised him as a Christian. So it made me really good. And I thought he did. I took my son in a country when he was 5 years old. My wife said, and she said, I don't know what you should know, he's got a bad cold. I said, honey, when he gets out among those balsam trees and smells down here, he'll be okay today. And that's exactly what happened. We had a wonderful time. You know, we came to a little river, and we canoed up this river, and there was a waterfall there, and a beaver dam, and there was a lake. And this beaver dam, and one was trickling over the dam, you know. We had enough travel to travel, enough water to travel in. But we were up there several days fishing, and when we came down, we raised the dam another foot or so, and there was more water left in the river. Nothing we couldn't do. We couldn't walk with all the equipment or couldn't do anything. So we tore the dam down. And Tim just, he got in there, my son. He was covered with mud, pulling the dam down, and he brought a blanket into him. He pulled as much. You can't do that if the dam is still for a year, just like concrete then. But this was just fresh, you know. And we were able to do that, get enough water in the river, and so travel again. He talks about it, he's 47 years old now. He says, that's what would happen. I'm sure he will. It's great to do. Do things with your kids. They're going to grow up in the adults someday. Okay. Walking up. Paul said, flipping to one, listen, I pray that you're allowed to be a bound. Yet more and more. I should be a growing love. More and more. See, the love of God is so great. You don't have to be empty. You're not going to wear it out. You're not going to do too much for the people. You're not out of love. That'll never happen. It's God you're talking about. This is the way that your love may abound. Yet more and more abound is more judgment. And then 1 Thessalonians 5:8, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet the hope of salvation. Putting it on. And then it says in 1 Timothy 6, flee is a great thing for a preacher, for a sermon. Flee, follow, and fight. Flee these things. He's talking about seeking to be rich. Flee these things. Follow after love. One of the things he mentions there, to follow after love. So something we have to walk in, continue in, follow after. Remember in 1 Corinthians 12, he says, seek for the best gifts, and yet I show to you a far better way. And that's 1 Corinthians 13. That's a far better way. Be filled, seek to be filled with the living God. Otherwise, the gifts you have will do nothing. They have to be operated by love, you know. The gifts of the Spirit. The Bible speaks about the love of the Spirit. Have you ever thought part of that? The love of who? The love of the Spirit. And then it speaks, that's in Romans 15:30. Then Colossians 1 speaks about your love in the Spirit. In the Spirit. I don't think, for 1 minute, I don't think that you can be filled with the Spirit of God if you're not filled with the love of God. When Moody was filled with the love of God, what did he say? He said, I was overwhelmed. I could have taken the whole world into my heart. I was so filled with the love of God. That was when he met with God on the sidewalk in Chicago. And his life was transformed. He became a world famous evangelist. And Finney had the same experience. What did he say? He said, I felt as if I was being fanned with gigantic wings of love. And he went for hours. It was another experience. So I asked somebody one day, Finney used to be filled with love. Yes, absolutely. I speak in tongues for 30 minutes every day. I said, you didn't ask me so many times, I asked if you're filled with the Spirit. She said, it's the same thing. I said, isn't the same thing? What do you mean? I said, well, you can't be filled with the Spirit of God unless you're filled with the love of God. Are you filled with the love of God? Her husband's standing there doing shared beyonds. She said, well, I have a couple of little problems. I said, tell me about your problems. She said, I'm insanely jealous of my husband. And he was going like this, you know. And then she said, I have some other problems too. I said, tell me about them. She said, well, you know, sometimes. times I cursed and swore. And then she started weeping, and she said, sometimes I blaspheme God. And I said, you're not filled with the Spirit, you're filled with self. And she found an easy one here to pray, not with God. Your husband just standing there watching, you know. But she didn't deceive, I guess, by some teaching. When you speak in tongues, you're going to be back to your filled with the Spirit. That's not necessarily true. It could be in some cases. I believe this is a genuine gift of tongues. I'm not speaking against it. I've never spoken in tongues. But the love of the Spirit, and your love in the Spirit, is connected, you see. So you can't really have one or the other. The older women are supposed to teach the younger women to love their husbands and to love their children. You know, sometimes the older women get together and talk about how loved the husband they are. And the Christian women do that too, you know. One church woman I once told, she was awful, she said, you get to these gals, and every one of them has anything good to say about their husband. And then I had to preach about that, you know. The older women to teach the younger women to love their husbands and to love their children. That's what you're supposed to be and to do. And then we're to provoke one another. Did you know that? It says in Hebrews chapter 8, to provoke one another. Did you do anything like to provoke other people? You should provoke one another to love and to good works. That's the way to provoke other people. Not the way we think of normally provoking people to make them angry. No. Provoke one another to love. If they want to follow your godly example and do what you're doing, perhaps, and move to the glory of God in loving other people. 2 Peter 1, 5 says, add in your faith love. So add it. Work at it. Work with God. Ask the Holy Spirit to fill every corner of your being. Did you ever read Andrew Miller's Prayer on Love? Anybody read that? Show me if you did. Raise your hand, nobody. It's the most amazing prayer I think I've ever read. I don't remember it from, you know, perfectly, but it was a fantastic prayer. He was asking God to fill him with the love of God. Fill me now, completely, totally, every ounce of my being, in all directions, so whoever I meet will sense, dear God, you're loving me. And I'm honored with a fantastic prayer. It's in a book written by a Chinese woman called Choi, and it's called Apostles of Abiding Love. That's what they call it in the Lord. Well, what a prayer. I prayed that prayer after I read it. It was such a wonderful, wonderful prayer. Let all your things be done with love in 1 Corinthians 16. Do everything you need to do with love. There's a crazy story about a lady, and her car was in a hailstorm and got badly dented, and some rag told her, they can easily fix that. Well, she said, how do you do it? He said, well, you're going to wait till the tailpipe cools down, and then just blow the tailpipe, and all these bumps will come out. Well, really? So she went home and waited for the tailpipe cooled off, you know. Then she went down and blown the tailpipe, and the neighbor saw her pleading. So what are you doing? She says, well, they told me if I blew hard enough that these dents would come out. Oh, no, she said, that won't happen unless you close all the windows. So, anyhow, we don't want to give that kind of advice. We are to be rooted and grounded in the love of God, Ephesians 3:17. Rooted and grounded. We say rooted and grounded in doctrine. That's good too. But rooted and grounded in the love of God. We will never be able to comprehend the whole senses of length and length and depth and height. And this is unto know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. And in case you're doubting, then it goes on to say, now, unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, unto him that dwelleth in the church by Christ Jesus to all ages, world without end, amen. Moody, as an older man, not long before he died, addressing 300 pastors, one of the things he said was this, brightly, he said, hold the churches to love have gone wrong. There have been probably many people found Christ who knew his labors. I was hearing from many pastors that ran in this room in church and all this kind of thing, and he saw the truth and saw the problem. Brethren, hold the churches to love. This is where we've gone wrong. This I pray, to go back to that verse again, this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more. We should be praying one for another that way, and for our churches. Because really, you know, when you think of it, revival is just an outburst of God's love in a congregation. I mentioned before this church in Alabama. It was that kind of a church. I was in the church for everybody might want to help me. Everybody, you know? And everybody wanted to talk about Jesus. Nobody had a funny story, a funny joke. I mean, they were singing to the church, but they talked about God and the love of God. Tell me more. What does this verse mean? It's such a great experience to be there. And when they sang, I knew something happened. Sometimes I couldn't sing because I was weeping. Oh, God is so crazy. There's nothing equal to the love of God in church. If you have to put up a sign, everybody welcome. These lessons. You don't have to put a sign like that up. If it's all in church, let me know. You'll finally fill it. And it's not just a case. I remember a fellow in Winnipeg, I don't remember his name. He was about 6'4" and a giant. He wasn't overweight, he was just a giant. And he was a Christian guy. And he used to welcome people to the Grand Memorial Baptist Church in Winnipeg. I can never forget that man. He'd see me coming, he'd come running to meet me and grab me by both hands and pump my arms and tell me he loved me and walk me to church. And he meant it, you know. He just felt blessed. He hadn't even been in the service. He was already blessed by this guy. So, rooted and grounded in love. Psalm 2:4 says, his banner over me was love. God's banner is love. He sheds his love in my heart, Romans 5:5. The love of God is shed abroad, poured forth in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who is given unto us. So God is willing to do it. But we were not willing to receive, not willing to receive, not wanting to. We are fearful in order to make some demands on our time that we don't want to give. So we get maybe a quarter full. And then it stops there. Be careful. We're chosen in Ephesians 1:4, chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him. That's the last 2 words. In love. You were chosen to be a loving person. Did you know that? We know that. And work to that end with God and his Spirit. The Lord make you to increase and abound in love, one toward another and toward all men, Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. The Lord make you to increase and abound in love, one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you. To the end. What was the end? To the end that he may, in the second, he's talking about the second coming. But when he comes back the second time, we may meet him with joy. Filled with the love of God. Make you to increase and abound in love. Ask God to do that for you. It's God who does it. We're taught of God to love 1 Thessalonians 4:9. We're taught by precept, commandment, example, or precept, 1 John chapter 4. Beloved, the word beloved means divinely loved ones. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. Never one that loves is born of God, knows God. He that loves not, knows not God. Do you know 1 John, those 5 chapters, there are 12 places where love is made the acid test of reality in Christian life. He that dwells in love dwells in God. He then will perceive the love of God because he laid down his life for us and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. all places that passeth pass. He that was not God. That's what it says. So true God, empty me, and fill me daily with your love. Ought to be our constant prayer. He's given us, remember, not a spirit of fear, 2 Timothy chapter 1, but a spirit of love and of power and a healthy mind. He has given us the Spirit of God who lives within you. It's a spirit of love. No matter what you may have done to him, he is still there. And he's a spirit of love. And so obviously, if I'm going to be filled with the love of God, I'm going to work with the Spirit of God. That's why he's living within us. And remember, the Lord just flashed it back into my mind in John 17. I declare to them your name, and will declare that the love with you is love me, may be in them. So it's not a Lord of great love, you know. If the love of what you have loved me, Christ said to God, may be in them. So I say me, it's not a lower or greater love. It's the same kind of love. It's his love. All right. The command to love, this command we have from him, that we who believe are to love. This comes out in 1 John chapter 3. I think very clearly. Now it's not love, it says in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. We can talk it, but to live it's another matter. We should talk it less and live it more. I think that's what God will have us to be and do. We're to believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. Now, as evangelicals, we've all done that, or we wouldn't be called evangelical. And then it goes on to say, and to love one another, as he gave his commandment. Now, he didn't say, these are his two commandments. He says, this is his commandment. It's one command. And you can't divorce the one from the other. This is his commandment, we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. That's the name of his commandment. So we need to know the name of the first part, but not the second part. Somebody forgot that, you know. Revival is an outburst of love. Finney said revival was an outburst of new obedience to God on the part of Christians. That's true also. Because you can't get on the fact that I remember back in those days of revival, people constantly, one guy gave his testimony, said, wife and I, we loved each other for years. He said, the love is up to your knees. He said, now the love is up to the sea, and you're swimming in the ocean of love, he said, you know. So that's how it can be to the praise and glory of God. He directs us into love. 2 Thessalonians 3:5 tells us the fruit of the Spirit, first thing, love, joy, peace, love is first of all. People, you know we miss it. How have we missed this? The Bible is loaded with it. I say again, how have we missed this? If we have, then let's do something about it. Now, our love may get cold, Matthew 24:12, because an initial amount of the love of many, the Greek is the love of the many, I guess it means the majority should get cold. Don't use that and hide behind what it says, everybody's going to get cold, so I might as well be cold too. Most of the time, we need to shine the brighter when the light is dark, you know. Because the Nicodemus, he's talking about the last days before he returns, and the love of many will get cold. You make that mistake. Church of Ephesus, they left their first love. And they warned, if you don't get back to the first love, I'm going to close you down. I'm going to close you down. And God closes churches sometimes. Because they're not right. They're not really representing him to the lost world. And there seems to be a lot of churches around, it's not being shut down. Maybe it's because they don't belong to God at all. It could be that, you know. I don't know how to get away. It's some of the kind of preaching you hear, or lack of preaching you hear. You mean God's huge congregation. 30,000 cause nothing. And there's always patting the people on the back and telling them, I'm here to help you. I don't want to hurt you. I'm here to help you. Our Buddhist congregation is loaded with people that have never been born again. And those who may be Christians and living in sin, he is wrong as he thinks he's doing it right. And I'll tell you what bothers me about that is the fact that one guy's in the ministry, this guy's got 30,000 people, I'm going to copy him. And that's what they're doing now. They're copying this guy. It's sad. So I know what God's going to have to do. Listen, he's been rocking like king. You know that? I believe it. I believe we're into a judgment mode right now. And I mean that, a judgment mode. You know what's happening? From the United States, we're close by, right? Didn't we have a tornado in Manitoba a while ago? A whole village disappeared just a few weeks back? It looks as if a gigantic bulldozer had gone through the village and there's nothing left. That happened in our country. But in the United States, they set a new record one night. They had 40 tornadoes in one night. They'd never had this before. And in 2 weeks later, they had 60 tornadoes in one night. What's God saying? Listen, this is what the Bible says. Stormy wind fulfilling God's word. He brings the wind out of his treasury and says in Jeremiah, I think it's chapter 7. He brings in Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 3. The Lord has his way in the whirlwind and in the storm. It's a big whirlwind that destroyed a city in the United States, New Orleans. That came from God. They're not saying that. Even the preachers are denying it. They're saying it's another nation, it's not another nation, it's Father God. The Lord has his will in the whirlwind, and in the storm, the clouds of the dust and the sea. And they're crying because the cod disappeared in the east coast of Canada, and the sand on the west coast are crying about this. What's happened? Nobody knows. The experts say they've gone somewhere. We don't know where they are. But in two places in the Bible, it says that God takes away the fish of the sea. And that's what's going on, see? And you know those big waves of hitting our nation, so many thousand, 200,000 people died altogether after that earthquake, those monstrous waves? You read about that in Nehemiah chapter 6. Anyway, here's what it says. The city that fell by a thousand, they turned by a hundred. Now I remember seeing in TV, you know, here's a group of people, in one case there was about 28 people, and the village originally had 88 people. This is all that survived. And that's what it says in that verse. The city went by a thousand, returned by a hundred. And you know what it says in the same context? The Lord calls for the waters of the sea and pours them out on the face of the earth. That's exactly the same. That's in chapter 6 and chapter 9. It says the same thing to me. That God calls for the waters of the sea and pours them out on the face of the earth. Okay. I think we're into a judgment mood. I'm positive we are. Look in BC. They have thousands of square miles of merchantable timber that's turned brown. All the trees are dead. You don't know why. They don't know why. There's some bug got in. It's the only thing that will kill those bugs is 20 below zero, and they haven't had that kind of weather for 2 winters, and they can't do anything about it. It's a judgment from God, you know. And so, too much rain, not enough rain, high winds. In Manitoba, the white shelter, we don't know about the white shelter. It's a tourist resort area in this part of the province. Let a storm go through all of one of those. And 1,000 cottages had trees fall on them. And people couldn't even get out of the place because there was so much timber on the highways and the roads, they couldn't get out. And besides that, there was holes in the road, 6 feet wide and more, they couldn't get out. And people had to walk on, some places to get out by boat somehow. What's God doing? People, he's just saying, wake up. Wake up. Wake up. He's talking to us, the church. He's not happy with the world we're living in, what we're doing. All these toys we buy and play with, you know, which could be used to evangelize, help evangelize the world. And God is not pleased with the way we're operating. Let them be hypocritical, let love be without hypocrisy, it says in Romans chapter 12. Hypocritical love? That's where we pretend, we smile, we said, the Lord's going to be here, and I hadn't heard of him, and said, he's going to make a song service. So he did. And about the third night, I saw him kneeling at the altar. I thought he'd gone to kneel somebody, but he hadn't. He told me afterwards, God spoke to my heart, I have to go and see my mother and make things right. So he went to see his mother. The problem was, his mother had left him when he was 2 years old, just let him go. And his uncle, whose name was Earl, had raised him. And he hated his mother with a passion. He finally left, his mother became a Christian, he became a Christian. He had nothing in his mother. He hated her with a passion. And God spoke to him about that. And that night he went to it. He said, you know, when I was walking down that last walk to my mom's house, there was just like a wind was blowing. Little demon hell was screaming at me. She left you, he never left her. She had nothing to do, you don't have to do it, don't do it. He said, and I kept on until I rang the doorbell. And he saw his mom and asked her forgiveness. He said, she's the sweetest in the world. And he persuaded her to move down to St. Louis, where he lived, and he got her a house, and he got her a car. He said, so I mean, something happened one day. There was a big church in the area, and the pastor followed the immorality. No, it wasn't in St. Louis, by the way, it was in another city. I didn't have it quite right. But anyhow, he said his wife one day, you know, I bet that preacher's hurting, I'm not going to see him. So he goes to the city, he finds the house, he's in the room, the lady came, he's submitting his bill on, and I wonder if I can see her husband for a few months. And she said, listen, my husband doesn't want to see anybody. Oh, he says, listen, I just want to pray for him, that's all. So she let him in, and she told him who he was, and he went to the room. He didn't knock on the door, he just walked in. And the preacher was kneeling at the side of the bed, and he opened his heart up. And then he went to the side and put his arm around him and said, my brother, I love you. He says, he got there and grabbed him and cried for about 10 minutes and kept saying, I didn't think anybody cared. I didn't think anybody cared. But that's how he was, and God took him on really, maybe he wanted him in heaven, I'm sure for some reason. Let me in closing say this. What is your goal? Do you want God's goal? You see, Paul says, from which some, not aiming at, have turned aside unto what? Unto vain jangling. One translation says, unto empty talk. Another translation says, unto a wilderness of words. It's all talk. If you don't have the right goal, and you're not filled with the love of God, then you're just a noise, you know? The clanging gong or clashing cymbal, he said. That's the goal that many have, the goal we must have. It's just to be empty of self and to be filled with the love of God. I remember one time when I preached in the lobbying camp years ago, and I was on top of a truck, and he's got a three-ton truck, maybe, loaded with stones to get away, chains on the back wheels, and he's pulling maybe six slaves, you know, going with lumber. And I got on top of one of those slaves. You have to be very careful, because the lumber was held on with a chain, and sometimes the load shifted. If you had your hand under the chain, you could lose your hand, you know. So I'm on top of that, and he can't go faster than maybe 30 miles an hour with this big load, you know. And I'm up on top of three buildings here, and I'm freezing to death, and the other says, you stupid fool. I mean, I didn't really give me a hard time that day. And I kept arguing, and finally said, oh, listen, shut up. I'm not listening to you any longer. I've had enough of this, you know. That's, it was a little thing. So I didn't freeze to death. One occasion I almost did, but on that occasion I didn't. And I walk sometimes 25, 30 miles a day with a pack on my back with New Testaments and tracts and stuff. Why, you know? Well, these guys need to hear. They used to work in bush camps and they look the kind of life they had. The will of God. It's so good. Occasionally somebody accepts Christ, you know. It's so good. It's so good.